Hi, and welcome to the Live and Invest Overseas podcast. I'm Kat Kalashian, and I am joined once again by our friend Con Murphy, based in Ireland. And he's here to talk to us today about how to buy real estate in Greece. And I have to say, Greece holds a very special place in my heart. I actually only first went there a few years ago for my baby moon, actually, while I was pregnant. But I've been obsessed with Greek mythology and Greek history and art for my entire life, and actually named my daughter after a Greek myth. So I have to say, it's one of my lifelong dreams to own someplace in Greece one day. And I've known several expats who have been in Paris and moved down to Greece and are very, very happy living down there, mostly just outside of Athens. But I also know some people living in the islands who say that life couldn't be more idyllic. So for anybody else who has these dreams of owning a little bit of the original fatherland of Western culture and history and everything else that we've based European and North American society on, come join us in Greece. And Con is here to tell us all about how to purchase properly, safely, and wisely in this European nation. So thanks for joining us today, Con.
Very much, Kat. Yes, indeed. Greece was one of the first countries that I traveled to when I finished high school. Me, friends of ours took 2 months. We traveled all around Greece, and it was a really spectacular country. As Kat mentioned, a beautiful country. It really is a land of water and sunlight and really endless coastline. With all those islands, it's got four times the coastline of Spain. I mean, it's pretty staggering the amount of coast you have there. It's really beautiful weather, beautiful climate in the Med. And there's some really great value property that you can find in Greece, depending on where you go. So some places are very expensive, and there's some places that you couldn't believe how cheap you can get property that's on or close to the coast on one of the thousands of islands they have there. Well, we're not going to go through locations and all that. We're just going through the property buying process. But just to give you an idea, Athens and islands like Mykonos are known to be quite more expensive than just say other places on the mainland, or Crete. They're much more affordable. So there's a huge range of prices and lifestyles you can select for. So, and it is an amazing country, and they're proud people with a rich culture. So there's an awful lot to do there. Another reason that the property in Greece can be so reasonably priced is something you need to know is that the Greek economy is kind of the European basket case, really. They're constantly nearly defaulting on their debts, but none of this really affects the property market or the tourism market. This is just their own endemic government problem. So you hear lots of stuff about the Greek economy. A lot of it's true. It doesn't affect you as an investor. Property prices go through their natural European property cycles, and tourism remains unaffected. But actually, tourism is boosted when the Greek economy is weaker because prices go down. Greece is also a very safe country in Europe to travel to, and so it really does have a lot going for it. So, residency in Greece. Most tourists can stay 90 out of any 180 day period in Greece. After that, they would need to leave and come back. If you stay more than 183 days in a year in Greece, you will need to apply for residency. There's ways of applying for residency, but the easiest route to residency is the Golden Visa residency program they have there. Currently, if you invest 250,000 euros in Greek real estate, you're eligible for a Golden Visa. This, however, is changing early next year. So there's only a few months left, and it probably wouldn't be enough time for someone to get to Greece, check out property and get the process going. But maybe we still have got 2 or 3 months before the new investment levels are coming. The other thing about the Greek residents, the Golden Visas, there's no minimum stay requirements in Greece. If you have the Golden Visa, you don't have to stay 6 months a year to keep it valid. And Greece does have a path to citizenship or a path to naturalization. After 7 years of residing in Greece, you can begin the process of getting a Greek passport. So all those are interesting. Other attractive reasons to look at Greece as a retirement destination is the flat 7% retiree pension tax. Any pension income you get from outside Greece is only taxed at 7% in Greece when you bring it to Greece. And Greece is a tax haven for high net worth individuals. People can opt, if you become resident in Greece, tax resident in Greece, you can opt to pay a flat 100,000 euros per year tax and nothing else. might seem a lot to you or I, but if you're a multi-millionaire or a billionaire, it's a pittance to pay. You just pay 100 grand, and no matter what you earn elsewhere in the world or in Greece, whatever else you earn elsewhere in the world, that's what you pay 100 grand, and that program is valid for 15 years. So it's very attractive for high net worth individuals from outside Greece to come and get tax residency in Greece. So the buying process in Greece is similar to all the rest of them. You obviously need to decide what you want to begin with. Are you looking for an investment home, an investment property, or are you looking for a home to live in, a home to retire in? That's purely up to you. I can't advise you on that. The decisions you do make yourself as well are, do you want to live in a city or in a village? Do you want to live in a built up party island? Do you want to live in a remote island? Do you want to live in the mountains? You know, there's a huge selection in Greece that you can choose from. So those are decisions you would make. And it's always best to take a bit of time, travel around the country and see what suits you best. I love the idea of spending time on a quiet Greek island, but some people want to be going to the party islands, of which there are dozens. The next question you got to ask yourself, do you want to buy a new build property in Greece? Do you want to buy it from a developer or from a builder? Do you want to buy a fixer-upper? New build properties, because of the pandemic, VAT on new builds was suspended until 2023. Once again, here we are in November 2022, so it's probably too close to 2023 to really get to take advantage of this VAT reduction from 23% to 3%. If you're considering fixer-uppers, we understand that given the economy in Greece, craftsmen and high-quality craftsmen are available, and you can get them, and they're not that expensive because the economy has its struggles. So that's a big difference from other locations. You try and find good craftsmen in parts of Europe, in Germany, in Portugal, a place like that, Spain. You just can't get them. There's so much demand in Greece. You can get them. You can get them at reasonable prices. You can buy a cheap 50,000, 60,000 euro property fixer-upper stone cottage and have some guys do it up for you. You could be into it for less than 100 grand and have some amazing work done for you. Other things to be aware of when you're buying Greece is roofs. Given the heavy tile roofs a lot of the older properties use, definitely need to be fully surveyed. And if it's older than, you know, if it's an older property, you're probably looking at replacing the roof either when you buy it or soon after when you buy it. It's just how it goes. And another thing to be aware of, given its location, Greece is affected by earthquakes, not massive ones, but you need to be aware too that the property needs to be built or rebuilt to a standard that can withstand mild earthquakes. This is something, obviously, you get advice from your local engineers. We're going to talk about the process of getting surveys and engineers in a moment. So the process of buying property in Greece is, obviously, you select the property you want, then you get a valuer from a local valuer. And it's good to get, if you're looking for a mortgage, it's good to get a valuer who's works with a local bank regularly or is known to them, and a surveyor. Especially, obviously, if it's a secondhand property, even if it has been renovated, you need to get it surveyed. Some of these properties are ancient. There could be structural issues you don't know about. You need to check out the roof. All these things need to be done. So definitely get a surveyor to review the property. If the property is new build, chances are you don't need a full survey done on it. But if there's any questions, it is always worth the few hundred euros you're going to spend to get a surveyor to give you peace of mind that the builder has got everything done correctly and done up to code. The next step you need in Greece is to get a lawyer. You should always get a lawyer when buying in a foreign country. They'll just walk you through the process. Ensure that they both speak English or whatever language you're comfortable in dealing in, and they're experienced with property transactions. Like all lawyers, some specialize in properties, some specialize in other things. Make sure you have one who's experienced in land law, in property law. The next step is to get a tax residency number. In Greece, that's called the AFM. You need this number if you want to own a property in Greece, if you want to own a car in Greece, if you want to earn income in Greece, you need an AFM. So your lawyer can assist you, or you can go to you can start the process yourself of getting an AFM. Then you should open a local bank account. It is recommended that you do for the buying process. I'll get into that later. Then you have while you're opening your local bank account and getting your tax numbers, your lawyer should be doing your due diligence. That's doing a full title search, checking if there's any mortgages or liens on the property, checking if there's any defects in the title. This is all normal stuff, any country you're in, but it helps to repeat that they have to do the full title search to make sure that everything is okay with the property. At that stage, you feel comfortable making a down payment. It's usually about 10%. That holds the property in your name while the notary public drafts up the new deed. He would obviously reference any sales contract that you've signed with the seller at the time for any terms and conditions involved in it. You sign the new deed in front of the notary public. You do require permission to own from the government, and this is vetted by the Ministry of Defence. This is usual in this part of the world. They just want to make that, obviously no terrorists are coming and knocking in their country. They want to know who's buying property in Greece, and really isn't an issue for you unless you're someone who's come to Interpol's attention a lot. Something to be aware of is the seller must be able to provide a tax clearance certificate and a green certificate, which is kind of an energy rating, how energy efficient the property is, to be able to sell the property. That's on the seller. It's not much you can do about it, but it is something that could hold up the buying process. So your lawyer needs to work with them to ensure they're able to produce these certificates when they're needed. And the last bit of advice we have in all these transactions, if you're American or from a non-Eurozone country, you should really consider a good foreign exchange service. If you're spending hundreds of thousands of euros or dollars buying a property in Greece, you can save several percent. You can get a better exchange rate, and you can get reduced fees by using a dedicated foreign exchange service. We recommend TransferWise, we use TransferWise. We don't specifically endorse them. We've got no financial benefit from recommending them, but we've always found them good to work with, and it can save you thousands of euros on a transaction. The next thing to be aware of is when you're transferring your money to buy the property, to buy your property, it is strongly recommended that you transfer the money into a local Greek bank account first, and then you use it to pay the seller and to pay your transfer taxes and fees. It is difficult, depending on the region, or impossible to pay the some of the taxes and fees from an international wire transfer. So you're going to have a Greek bank or be able to get a Greek bank draft to pay some of these fees. So opening a Greek bank account is helpful and necessary, and it's worth the effort. The other things about getting residency in Greece is that it gets you healthcare rights in Greece. It gets you a very discounted healthcare. It doesn't get you free healthcare. You would need to register to work in Greece and or be paying Greek social security to get free healthcare like Greek nationals do. The next thing to be aware of is your property transfer tax. That's about 3%. It goes to the government, and a tiny amount. It's oftentimes like 3% of the 3% you pay to the government, to the local municipality. Annual property taxes, there's a couple of them. Don't get worried, they're not that expensive. It's usually between 2 and 13 euros per square meter of the size of your property. It's usually averages out about 4 euros per square meter. And then there's a supplementary property tax that you pay over the first 250,000 euro value of your property. You pay 0.1% for the first 200,000 over the value. That's from 200,000 to 300,000, you pay 0.15. From 300,000 to 400,000 euros above the minimum value of 250,000, you pay a 0.25%, and thereafter up and up until you can be paying 1.15% on properties valued at over 2 million euros. Your lawyer will explain this to you when you engage them. Mortgages are possible, foreigners to get in Greece. Generally, mortgages are maxed out at about 75% loan to value, but foreigners, and given the additional closing costs, foreigners oftentimes can only find themselves able to get about 50 or 60% of the total cost of buying the property from the bank. The banks vary on their requirements. So it's very important to get a broker. You could spend a lot of time going from bank to bank, and you still wouldn't get as good a deal as you would by getting a Greek broker who's experienced working with foreigners. I mean, it's a different process than a Greek mortgage broker getting a mortgage for a Greek person. After that, we have got rental taxes. The Greek government encouraged people to rent out property, but the tax rate goes up quite steeply. It's for the first 12,000 euros you get in rental income, you only pay 15% tax on that. From 12,000 to 35,000 euros in income, you pay 35% tax on that. And from above 35,000 euros a year in rental income, you pay 45% tax on that. So something to be very aware of, that Greece, that the taxes get quite onerous the more income you earn in Greece. So you need to factor that into your investment return analysis, that you might not want to get too many rental properties in Greece, because the tax really becomes punitive after 35,000 euros at 45%, it can wipe out most or all of your profits. Closing costs or the other costs that are involved in buying property are pretty simple. The real estate agent charges 2 to 2.5%. That's paid by the seller. So that's not your issue until you go to sell your property again. Legal fees, they vary. Once again, it's a sliding scale, but a sliding scale in your favor this time. It's 1% on the up to the first 44,000 euros value of the property. The 0.5% then from 44,000 euros to 1.462 million euros. So it's generally, most of it's at 0.5%. And after 1.46 million euros, you pay a 0.04% tax, which is a slight reduction on the amount you pay. Notaries fees vary between 0.65% and 1%, depending on how much work they have to do and the notary himself. And there's a registration fee of 0.5%. And all these closing cost fees, they're all subject to VAT at 23%. So add on 23% onto those there. And there we have it. That's a very quick synopsis of the Greek property buying process. As I say, there is a huge range of properties you can buy all over the country. It's an amazing country. You should definitely check it out. Spend some time traveling around. It's a world tour in a single country.
Absolutely. I'm so impressed and jealous that you were able to spend 2 months there. That sounds like a fantastic way to see Greece. I actually also knew a family who, I think they spent a month, maybe 6 weeks exploring the islands by boat. And they actually, just boat hopped from island to island, which is amazing because so many of the islands are, you know, inhabited, very developed, but so many of them are not. There are just rocky little outcrops with a population of a few sheep.
and you can zip between them. We did some of that. I found Athens can get very hot during the summer, and that's a common complaint about the place. But the islands, there's always a breeze on the islands, and some of them, you say, are tiny. Some of them is just one little village, other ones are full towns. Some of them are absolutely packed with tourists year round. So whatever you want.
you really can get it all in Greece. You can choose. Do you want to be in that very well-developed, full of amenities kind of towns for tourists, or the party towns, like you said, or these completely rural agrarian societies? And it's funny that you mention about Athens, because I think that is possibly my only complaint about Greece. I was there in August and I was 5 months pregnant, so that was hell. But speaking more about Athens as a place, it's possibly the only city that I've ever been to that I really didn't like. And it's funny, I've heard that from so many different people. Athens, it just to put this out there, if you are going to Greece, don't base your judgment of the country on where you land in Athens airport.
So much else. Even on the mainland, there's so much else to see. There's cooler mountains and all that. But the islands really seem to be where the foreigners gravitate towards too. And as I said, there's everything from little shepherding villages to modern towns.
Yeah. And it is funny because we were speaking about Cyprus recently, and Cyprus also has a very strong Greek connection. So parts of Cyprus can actually feel as if you were on a Greek island. So it's interesting to draw that connection. So if anybody is on the fence. You know, you're thinking you would like to look closer at some Mediterranean islands. Don't forget that there are islands outside of Greece or Italy, or, you know, these places where we know the islands very well. You know, Spain's islands are very well known, but Cyprus is a little bit more off the beaten track. So if you are interested, head on over to our Cyprus video. All right. Thanks for joining us today, Khan, and we'll speak with you again soon. Don't forget to like the video, send us any comments, questions, complaints, and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. Thanks for taking the time to be with us today, and happy trails.